I wish to say one thing and make another forewarning, that if perhaps we need to have a little bit of a background of the context in which these texts have been written. Professor Crosby has already mentioned the relation of Wojtyła to de Lubac. I think we should attract more of de Lubac in our personalist consideration, because he really belongs to the history of personalism. Yes, he's a theologian, but his theology has a tremendous impact on philosophy, and also on the philosophy of Wojtyła. Where is this impact? There, in the 18th, and even more in the 19th century, we have had a strong turn towards subjectivism in European philosophy. As a reaction to this, Catholics have stressed strongly the objectivistic aspect of philosophy. And so we run the risk of having, on the one side, a word that is made only of objects, and on the other hand, a word that is made only of subjects. On the lay side of European philosophy, then you have had a split. One part of lay European philosophy, mainly in France, has again taken up the object, but the object not in the metaphysical sense, but in the sense that is defined by natural science. Positivism has been one main trend of modern philosophy, whilst on the other hand, mainly in Germany, they have taken the subject without the object, that is a subjectivism in which the object is forgotten. On the other side, an object without a subject, with the risk of a part of neo-Thomism, perhaps, well, I shall not say whether a large or a small part of neo-Thomism, of falling prey to the purely objectivistic vision of man and of reality. Henri de Lubac felt the need of, this, by the way, in the field of theology, this went hand in hand with a vision that separates completely nature from supernature. There is a nature created by God, and man has in this nature an end that is appropriate for him, and he can accomplish himself perfectly within this sphere of nature without revelation, without... in one sense, we have a Catholic equivalent of de la cité des athées, of Bale. And Bale is dependent to a large extent on Suarez. It's a kind of atheist reworking of Suarez. And on the other hand, you have the word of supernature. It is a word that has little to do with the word of nature, if anything. What is the reason of this? They were afraid that the closer connection of nature with supernature could give the impression that the sacrifice of Jesus Christ is already a part of nature, and then that man does not really need grace, does not need a supernature, that nature is sufficient to itself. So they are separated. At the end of the 20th century, and then in the beginning of the 20th century, you have a great movement, and de Lubac is the mature expression of this movement, a great movement that tries to reconcile nature and supernature, showing that there is a distinction, of course, but man is made in such a way that he can find his fulfillment only in God. And there is no such thing as a good world in which we can live without God, a good society without God, a natura pura, a pure nature in which man can be happy without God, or perhaps with God, but without Jesus Christ the Savior. but all creation is oriented towards this completion that is Jesus Christ. And without Jesus Christ, man remains in a tragic situation. He cannot really find the truth about himself. He's always shaken between the affirmation of truth and the negation of truth, which is similar and different from Hegel, from that dialectic of Hegel. Professor Crosby tomorrow will speak about Guardini, the polar dialectics of Guardini. In Hegel, the dialectic is not polar. There is the synthesis, and the synthesis takes place in history. In Guardini, the dialectic is rather Pascalian. There is a terrible tension, and man can find the solution of this tension through his own forces alone. So man is somehow, and the correct position of man is that of praying, of waiting for an help that must come from above. What does this have to do with Wojtyła? Can you imagine? You have read this text. Having read this text, what comes to your mind? Think especially of the second part of this text. Is anybody of you willing to give an answer? Or does anybody of you find the reason why I am telling these things about the Lubac? Nobody is willing to take the risk of an answer?
Yes.
Yes, good, gone. Your name? Excuse me, I don't know you.
My name is
Michael. Michael, wonderful name. That of an angel, gone.
The first thing that I think of is...
louder.
He makes the connection between anthropology and ethics. So connecting like what we are to what we do, that would bear it would bear importance to like how we understand like what our final end is, whether it's a purely natural end or whether it's a supernatural end of God, like a natural desire for the supernatural.
Good. Well, that is very good. Also, I don't think it is an answer to my question. It further develops on the Lubac. The natural desire to see God is the point through which nature and supernature are connected with one another. That's true. But what about Wojtyła? What about this text? What about the second part of this text? The beautiful lady, what is her name?
Mary,
from an archangel to the mother of God, wonderful, a wonderful progress.
The concept of participation, I'm not a theologian, but if I remember correctly about the Lubac, he spoke about Apex Day, like our capacity for God and participating, communion, I guess. I don't know
that. Wonderful. That's the point, communion. That's the reason why I suggested you to read not only this article, but two other articles that complement this one, and they both have in themselves the word communio. One is Rogina Iacocomuni, the family as a communion of persons, and the second one is being father and mother. I don't know how they translated it. It's rodzicielstwo in Polish. As a communio personarum, a communion of persons. That's the idea of communion. We will deal tomorrow or the day after tomorrow with the wonderful presentation of Josef Ratzinger of the concept of person and the deep links between the concept of person and the Trinitarian reading of the essence of God, no? But what is Wojtyła doing here? Remaining a philosopher, not going one step farther than the borders of philosophy. Remain so much a philosopher that his reading is sometimes rather difficult because it's very technical. But what is he doing here? He's showing us that in the natural tensions of human life, in the natural dimension of human life, there is a powerful drive towards communion, the participation, not in the life of God here, but each one in the life of the other. Man is not made to be alone. Man is made in order to participate in the life of the other person. And each man can participate in the life of another person, and each man discovers, in one sense, himself in the relation I-Thou. When you only see yourself in the mirror of another human person, and then you discover what you are, what you really are. And the relation to the other is, in one sense, constitutive of our being persons. In a way that is different from the way of God, of course, because there is a certain primacy of the subjectivity of the individual on the community. But nevertheless, man is made in such a way that he can be himself only in relation to others. And this being in relation is given since the beginning. We could say that we see here, in a strong analogy to Edith Stein, and less, but to a certain extent also to Max Scheler, a kind of reformulation of the cogito of Descartes. I think I am, but the I am is not the pure subjectivity. I am, that is me. It was said very well by Professor Crosby, me with my body. But my body implies two things. One thing is that I was born. My body was born. My body was born after having dwelled for 9 months in the womb of my mother. So I cannot say I am without implying in my I the existence of another person, that is my wife. No, excuse me, this comes later, my mother. First, my mother. And that is not all, because my mother was not a virgin. And if I was born, there was this woman, but there was also one man, that is my father. And in saying I imply the relation to these two human beings and to many others, because they were human beings, they had fathers and mothers, and so on. And that's not all. In saying I cannot forget that I have discovered myself a first time in the loving eyes of my mother, but the second time in the loving eyes of a girl who looked to me with a kind of brightness that has melted down my heart, and we have become husband and wife, and we had children. And so the I of man is not just a pure subjectivity. It is a really existing subject, and the really existing subject is in relation to many other subjects. And that's the reason why the title is The Person, Subject, and Community. The first part of the article, it is a kind of recapitulation, repetition of Osoba Ichien, of the great book of Wojtyła on person and act. The second part, that is the most innovative part, and goes beyond Osoba Ichien, is centered exactly on this issue. I am in relation with others. But this is a way of showing philosophically that man is made for communion. Because participation is the way in which we say in the language of philosophy the word communion. Can this truth be considered as a purely philosophical truth? Yes, you have here a very sound philosophical demonstration that man is ontologically made in this way, and that it is true, it is so. Nevertheless, it is not by chance that this idea of the human person was developed in a Christian environment. And it appeared first in the controversies of the 4th, 5th century on the person of Jesus Christ and on the Trinity, on the Incarnation and on the Trinity. So this is one aspect of the background. You must read this on the background of the attempt to constitute a different connection between nature and supernature, showing that nature implies a demand for supernature, as tends towards the communio. Can man reach the communio alone without the a particular grace of God? That is a key issue. This was also, well, you can find this question twice in the history of philosophy. The first time you find it in the essay that Karl Marx, he was 18 years old, I think it was 18 years old, yes, it was 18 years old, in his matura, in the exam at the end of high school, he wrote an essay, he was asked to write an essay, commenting John, the great speech of Jesus in chapter 15 and following of St. John. You receive a new identity through the relation to me, and this new identity creates a new relation among you, and you become one. Many become one. Not only the Father and the Son are one, but only you, my disciples, my friends, those who have entered into my life, not only through the bond of the flesh, through the bond of the spirit, you all, we all become one. And then the young Karl Marx asks the question, but do we need Jesus in order to become all one? And the same question was asked by a great theologian several years later, criticizing the Lubac. Is this new theology, la nouvelle théologie, it was called, is this nouvelle theology implying that, after all, this unity of mankind is the result of of the natural forces of man, does not really imply the need of Jesus Christ? This is a fundamental question in the history of philosophy and in the history of theology. Do we run this risk? Who is willing to give an answer? Now think not so much of the second part, but of the first part, of the way in which Wojtyła explains to us the structure of human experience. Do we run this risk? Mary. But really, we need a loudspeaker.
I don't remember if I'm thinking of the beginning of this reading or a different reading, but doesn't he say that when that we, if we try to do it without Christ, that the results are deplorable? Like we see in societies that have tried to do it, like in communism, for example, then it was the practical results were awful.
I am not so sure. By the way, you don't find the word Christ in this essay. It's a purely philosophical essay, please. I think we should consider the relation obtaining between knowledge and conscience. Here, Wojtyła gives us a theory of the self-constitution of the person. We will see it better tomorrow when we read the article on the self-constitution of the human person through the human praxis. My consciousness is dependent on my faculty of knowledge. consciousness is not a cognitive faculty. So I know, there is a word out of me, and through knowledge, through my faculty of knowledge, I get in touch with this word out of me. And there is an initial passivity of human knowledge. But then, what I receive from my faculty of knowledge has to be accepted, subjectivized. I must recognize this word as my word. I must recognize this truth as my truth. But, and in order to do this, I must accept as the fundamental law of my life the obedience to truth. This cannot be imposed from the exterior. This must be an act of my freedom. But my freedom is an infinite capacity of saying, no, I don't. I do not accept this reality. And I become really myself if I can say yes. And if I say no, I do not become really myself. I rather destroy myself. I grow as a man through saying yes. And to say yes is not just a passive act. It is an active act. Take the example of gender. I am a male. Yes. It is enough that I say yes to the fact that I am male? No. Why? Because there are 1 million ways in which one can be a male, and 1 million ways in which one can be a woman. And I have to find my own way of being a man or a woman. I have the fortune of living in a family with a strong female predominance. I can say the way in which my mother was a woman is very different from the way in which my sisters are women, or my wife is a woman. And even much more different from the way in which my daughters are women. And I cannot imagine the way in which my grandchildren will be women. And this is a cultural fact. It changes in time. And it is right that it should change in time. So when you speak of gender, the idea that being a woman is a cultural fact is right. What is wrong? It is wrong when, because there are some people who make a correct use of the concept gender, but it becomes incorrect when some of them remember what Professor Crosby said a few moments ago. There is an irreducible in man, and also in women. there are elements of female identity that do not change, while others do change. The fact of becoming mothers, of having the capacity of becoming mothers, the fact of developing the attitude that allow you to become a mother, and in order to become a mother also a wife and so forth, all this does not change. But the way in which this becomes concrete, this does change. There is a great Italian philosopher, Antonio Rosmini, who has developed the concept of modality of right, modality of being. The modality may be different. The essence remains the same, but the modalities are different. And you must investigate the cultural modalities that correspond to the essence now, under the given circumstances. And you can correct injustices that were incorporated in the idea of womanhood of yesterday, and perhaps you may incorporate in the new idea of womanhood other injustices that the next generation will correct. That's history. That's the interaction with history. In doing this, you have a duty of incorporating. You have the duty of being creative. Man creates together with God, not starting from nothing like God, starting from a first gift of being that is given by God, but man is really a creator of worlds, of civilizations, of families, of cultures. And this is something that the purely objectivistic vision did not see, at least not with this clarity. This is the great contribution of what he was phenomenology to the understanding of man and of society. But in doing this, you have an obstacle, a tremendous obstacle. You have a duty of subjectivizing true consciousness. And in subjectivizing true consciousness, you start with your body. You remember, we have said the cogito voitiva. Voitiva is no cogito, but we are simplifying his thought, attributing to him the cogito. The cogito voitiva is a cogito that includes the body. Since it includes the body, it includes the body for good and the body for bad. Including the body, it includes also the emotions that are in part a result of the body and in part also a result of the higher values with which you enter into cognitive contact through the recognition of truth. The emotional sphere of man has two poles. One pole is the pole of the recognition of the higher values. The other pole is the attraction of the lower values. Here, Wojtyła uses heavily the contribution of Schiller, although with some significant variations. And so it may happen, and it does happen. I want to go back to the question, what is your name? I did not catch your name. It was not the last, one of the last questions. That's you, yes. No, him.
Christoph.
That's the question of Christoph. Well, yes, it is difficult. It is the problem of sin. It is the problem that conscience is emotionalized. That is, in conscience, lower emotions gain the upper hand. And they make it difficult for, they deform the knowledge of truth in such a way that you cannot affirm truth. You know what, there are two forms. One form, there is a wonderful drama of Wojtyła, The Jeweler's Shop. I suggest the reading to every one of you. At a certain point in this drama, there is Anna. Anna got married to Stefan. They were two, they fell in love, and they got married. They loved each other. To love is different from just falling in love. The falling in love is linked to the I-Thou relation. You remember? You read it. It does not use the expression falling in love, but he uses it in the jeweler's shop and also in Love and Responsibility. Falling in love is a I-Thou relation. To get married, to love, is a we relation. Not just I feel this, not just emotions arising in me, but I pledge. There is the decision of my freedom. And this is based on knowledge, and it is confirmed in consciousness, interiorized in consciousness. And consciousness has a lot to do with this, because in principle, I could get married to all women of this earth, but only one of them is interiorized in that way. No? And then she does not feel anymore. She cannot recognize him as her husband. She knows it is so. She does not feel like that. She cannot stand it. And she's about to ride away on a casual pillion, would say Eliot. You remember Eliot? Your daughters ride away on casual pillions. It is a verse that is almost repeated in Wojtyła. Wojtyła loved Eliot, and sometimes he imitates Eliot. She's about to ride away with another man. And then she meets Adam, and Adam tells her, no, love is not a passion. Love must stay with truth. And what is Adam? Adam is man, but Adam is the presence of Christ in the history of man. Without that, you could not do. What you know is true. That's the mystery of sin. But there's another mystery, and in this text you do not find so much, well, in the first part you can find the mystery of sin, exactly in the explanation of the relation between consciousness and knowledge, and the possible emotionalization of consciousness. But you find in the second part not so much sin, but rather alienation. Alienation is not the same as sin. Men should live taking part one in the life of the other. Each man should recognize the other as a subject who makes the experience of him being an I from within, like I make this experience. And this experience can meet and can enrich each other, and we can become a we in different ways, with your wife in one way, with the people with whom you work on the working place in another way, with the citizens of your nation in another way, with all men in another way, in the different ways through which human communities are built and are interrelated to one another. But human cooperation is not just built on the basis of this recognition. You may have a human relation that is a relation in which the other is present, but not as a person, not with that irreducibility, not with that irreplaceability of the person. I reconstruct in me the whole of reality, and I give my assent to reality, giving of reality my creative interpretation that is complemented by yours and by that of others. That's a possibility of human relation to others. But it is also possible that I do not live a creative relation to reality. And my relation to the other is a relation of in which I try to exploit the other and he tries to exploit me. Again, I feel I should quote Eliot. Will you say that you stay together in order to make money one out of the other? Is that the reason why you stay together? And will you call yourself a city? Now you have this idea of community and society, remember. Community and society. A society is a system in which people work together. It is considered from a mainly objective point of view. And a society can be the external side of a community, but can be also void, like some trees that have lost their inner life and they stay there just for a while. And now you can have an alienated society in which men do not participate one in the life of the other. I do not enter into a contact with you because I love you. I enter into a contact with you because I have the role of being a professor, and now I am exercising my role of being a professor. You are students and in this moment, and you exercise your role of being students. But beyond the role, there is nothing. This is alienation. Marx, and here you have another background. You have spoken of the Lubach, but there was a Marxist background. Marx said alienation is also a Marxist concept. Alienation is the result of the economic structure of society. And what he would say is, no, alienation is first of all, well, the economic structure of society may participate in alienation, but the real root is the attitude of men to one another. The fact that they have lost the capacity of interiorizing reality, and they leave the world as a purely objective world that is not the outcome of their creative intervention, together with others, because they are not capable of being really together with others. And the unity of society is made through command. Somebody has the command and he imposes to us what we should do, and we do it, and we are all together. Society more or less functions, but it is everybody, perhaps we could even imagine a Christian society that is alienated, in which everybody does the right thing, what is objectively right and true, but not out of his freedom, out of the participation of his heart. And they do not participate one in the life of the other. And that would not be similar to paradise. It would rather be similar to hell. the alienation. Here, again, I could quote Eliot, but here, Eliot, you remember in the beginning of The Wasteland, when he sees so many people moving up and down through the London bridges, so many, and they are all dead. They think they are alive, but they are all dead. An alienated man is a man who seems to be alive, but he has no interiority, so he's dead. So many. I did not think death had undone so many, which is, excuse me, I am an Italian, a translation and an unquoted citation of Dante. Ch'io non credea che morte tanta n'avesse disfatta. That is the alienated society, the other possibility. Alienation is not just sin, something similar to sin and different from sin. It has rather to do with what we might call a social structure of sin. Sin is also always individual, but sins of many people influence the life of others. And if you are raised up in an alienated society, you are likely to participate of alienated patterns, also you are not directly personally responsible for them. You are, as Tadeusz used to say, innocence, said innocence. You are innocent, but what you do is wrong and is damaging to yourself and to others. Imagine a man who lives in a slave society, in a Slavic society, in which slavery is allowed, is accepted as a normal life system. Well, he will be in a situation in which he will not be responsible for directly, immediately, for many sins. But shall we say, well, fine, go on like this because you are not responsible for your sins. Keep on sinning because you are not responsible or not fully responsible. No. On the other hand, you must recognize that it is a limited responsibility. On the other hand, you must try to move him to awaken his conscience. Von Hildebrand has a similar concept that is extremely enlightening. The concept, well, enlightening, although it is the concept of moral blindness. You are morally blind, you do not see. And moral blindness is not a sin, although St. Thomas Aquinas would say that perhaps it is the consequence of sins, of your sins or of the sins of your fathers, of the sins of your society, and so forth. So here you have also a political push, because you have to change societies in which structures of sin are embodied. You can't think of societies in Latin America in which millions of people are condemned to an abject poverty. You can think of societies that are more near to us in which millions of people are expropriated from the right of understanding what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman, to create a family, to have children, and are alienated not from the world of production, but from the world, perhaps even more important, of the production of human life. That is the fulfillment of your vocation, because you learn what is communion as a rule through marriage. Why is marriage a sacrament for the Catholic Church? Because to most of us, the other people we meet, it is very difficult that we really see them as persons. In most cases, we pass by, we just consider the social role that they have, and that's enough. Here's my professor, he's supposed to deliver his class. Well, when I have listened to the class, it's over. But now and then, you fall in love, you get married, you have children. There, the relation to the person, the fact that the other person is a part of yourself, that you cannot say I without implying her in the I that you say, then this becomes real. And if you make it impossible for people to live this experience, then you destroy their humanity.